Hello. Let us continue our discussion on hawk roosting by Ted Hughes. In our previous discussion, we have identified that how the hawk was different from the other representations of the birds that have been found in the Romantic and Victorian literature. Now let us begin with the text, and then we can identify that how the hawk that have been presented by Ted Hughes here in this particular poem, Hawk Roosting, is somehow different from the other birds in this particular fashion. You see that so far as this particular poem is concerned, this poem is actually interpreting the power politics. Okay, the particular perspectives of the Foucauldian concept of power, okay, and how power is originated and how power is exercised. Okay, in the form of, say, different kinds of exploitations and subjugations in each and every perspective, all these things can be found in this particular poem also. You will find that the version, it is not a kind of a descriptive poem. Rather, you will find that the typical I that actually comes at the beginning of this particular poem, we will find that as if the hawk is speaking. And so the whole poem will be a particular kind of a monologue by the hawk. The hawk is speaking. The hawk is actually exposing his inertia. So ultimately, it begins in this particular fashion. I sit in the top of the wood, my eyes closed. In action, no falsifying dream. Between my hooked head and hooked feet, or in sleep, rehearse perfect kills and eat. So that is the first stanza of this particular poem. What does it implicate? You will find that so far as this particular poem is concerned, as I mentioned just now, that it is the version of a hawk. And hawk is stating that I am sitting in the top of the wood and my eyes are closed. Remember, the title of this particular poem is Hawk Roosting. That means the hawk that is actually resting. What happens, you know, that when the hawk actually rests, as the poem actually indicates, that it is not that it completely takes rest. Rather, everything runs within the mind. Now, what happens as I'm stating, every time I'm stating, that whenever you will go with this particular poem, that is Hawk Roosting, there you will find there are ample provisions of relating the hawk with a power maniac, relating the hawk with a person who is exercising power within the society. And now, from that particular perspective, if we try to relate the hawk with the typical cultural theories, then you will find that if we attach the typical theory of feminism, then you will find the hawk is representing a patriarch. If you try to identify the imperialism, then the hawk can be associated with an imperialist. And from that particular point of view, we can attach the concept, the names of Mussolini or Hitler with the hawk. Similarly, if we try to attach the theory of post-colonialism, then ultimately you will find the hawk is actually representing, a colonist in that particular perspective. Or maybe if we try to attach the theory of Marxism, then the hawk can also be associated, the hawk can also be classified as a typical bourgeois capitalist. So each and every perspective can be used in this particular poem. And now you will find that everywhere, whenever you are thinking in terms of a patriarch, or maybe a bourgeois capitalist, or maybe an imperialist, or maybe, a colonist, everywhere you will find that the dream, you know, it is not a kind of a falsifying dream that is running within his mind. Rather, these are the blueprints, you see. Blueprints for what? Blueprints regarding the creation of your empire. Blueprint regarding the exploitations and subjugations. Okay, different kinds of tortures, different kinds of exploitations, different kinds of subjugations. Everything can be associated, that can be related with this particular form. The Foucauldian concept of panopticon can also be classified with this particular poem in this particular form, where you can find that everywhere we are within the social gaze, you see, that the upper section, the upper strata in a typical pyramidal structure of the society, the upper strata is always looking at you. Okay, why? Because you have been controlled. Just like the image of a puppeteer, everywhere you will find that the puppets have been controlled by the upper hand, you see, the person who is sitting above you. So ultimately, what it indicates, I am sitting in the top of the wood. Do you consider that this particular poem is actually representing a jungle, and you see that the bird is sitting in the top of the wood, or rather the wood is actually signifying the society? So ultimately, you will find that as it is a famous modernist writing, so you will find that such kind of metaphoric associations can also be classified in this particular form. So I sit in the top of the wood, my eyes closed, and you will find in action, no falsifying dream. So there is no particular kind of provision of dream to come within me, because I know what is my status, because I know what I have to do. It is, I know that how to exploit others and earn money and get power. You see, it is the typical Foucauldian structure that Pade Hughes is actually working. So I sit in the top of the wood, my eyes closed, in action, no falsifying dream, between my hooked head and hooked feet. You see, again, another very significant impression that it uses. Hooked head and hooked feet. What it means? You know that there is a kind of a coordination must have to be taken place for any particular kind of an action. What kind of coordination? What you think and what you act, you see. So therefore, you will find that it is not simply the hooked feet. Rather, it is actually indicating the hooked conceptions, the hooked thoughts that is prevalent or prevailing within the head of this hawk. So it cannot be possible that the head be hooked. You can find that the hooked position can be associated with the beak of the hawk. But rather, when the particular kind of an epithet that is hooked is associated with the head, actually the object is being transferred to the hooked ideologies. Right? So therefore, as the particular image is that of a hawk, and you can find the image of a predator has been incorporated here in this particular poem. So fundamentally, you will find that the poem is actually indicating the particular procedure of killing others. And in that form, you will find that when the killing others temperament is being invoked, the hooked head is actually signifying the blueprint regarding killing others or exploiting others. So that's why in the fourth line, you will find that in sleep, I rehearse. Rehearse what? Perfect kills and eat. So from the hawk's perspective, we can find that the kills and eat are very natural for him or for it. But so far as the colonialist or colonist or maybe the patriarch is concerned, we will find that killing and eating, it is actually indicating towards something different. Now just think that it is being spoken regarding the Nazi atrocities by Hitler. And then you will find that the temperament of the poem certainly gets changed. So that is the significance of this particular poem. It is not simply referring in terms of the hawk. Rather, it can be indicated in terms of some social structures and the social inequalities and different kinds of exploitations that is working within the society. So that is the fundamental focus of this poem. Again, it says the convenience of the high trees, the air's buoyancy, and the sun's ray are of advantage to me. So ultimately, we'll find that everywhere, you will find that the hawk is trying to identify what are the advantages that I actually enjoy. Okay, there are convenience of the high trees because it is sitting on the top branches of a tree. Okay, and again, in the air's buoyancy so that it can soar properly. And the sun's rays, you see, that it actually helps the hawk in killing others. These are of advantage to me. So do you not feel that the high trees and air's buoyancy or the sun's rays, these are all indicating different issues so far as the societal perspectives are concerned? You will find the high trees are signifying the upper strata of the society where, you know, the power is being enjoyed by any predator, okay, quote unquote predator like Hitler or Mussolini or others. So the convenience of the high trees, it is actually signifying the upper strata of the society that is in work. If you think of the air's buoyancy, do you not think that what can provide you the buoyancy? Is it not the power of money that is being indicated? And then if you think of the sun's ray, do you not think it is the political power that it indicates? Because the sun is the source of all power, all energy. And ultimately, you will find that so far as the society is concerned, there, the ray is actually indicating towards the particular kind of political regime, a political power that it actually enjoys. So the convenience of the high trees, the air's buoyancy, and the sun's ray are of advantage to me. And the earth's face upward for my inspection. So it is not that it is the state of earth and I am belonging to the earth. Rather, the earth's face is being kept upward for my inspection. So the perspective has been changed. And you will find that it is the typical bird's eye, the typical quote-unquote hawk eye view that it indicates. Remember the Google Earth formations. So ultimately here it is being stated, the earth's face, here the earth is actually signifying the people in general, the society in general. Their face is upward for my inspection. Here I must suggest you to read or Google the particular concept of Panopticon by Michel Foucault. The concept of Panopticon, where you will find the pyramidal structure and everywhere, every person is under the social gaze. Each and every moment you have been controlled by the society. When you are belonging to the lower section, you will find that the upper section is controlling you. When you are thinking in terms of your religion, you will find one particular religion is dominating. Okay? When you think in terms of the international politics, you will find one particular country is dominating others. So everywhere you will find the power politics is originating. The power politics is in work. So ultimately, you could identify that from your individual level to your international level, ultimately everywhere the panopticon, the social gaze, the social, say, hierarchy is always in work. So that is being suggested with this particular impression. That is being suggested with this particular kind of, say, representation that is being presented here. Then the hawk says, my feet are locked upon the rough bark. It took the whole of creation to produce my foot, my each feather. Now, that is the irony, I hold creation in my foot. You see that my feet are locked up on the rough bark. It is very easy. You can identify what it indicates, that it is sitting in a branch or on a branch of a tree. And that's why the rough bark is there and my feet are locked there. And then it suggests it took the whole of creation, that means the society, to produce my foot, my each feather. So ultimately, you will find that I have been created by the society itself. I have been created by these people. And ironically, when I gather the power, when I am enjoying the power, now I am holding creation in my foot. So ultimately, that is the typical form of irony. That means whenever you will think of a patriarch, whenever you are thinking in terms of a colonist, or maybe a bourgeois capitalist, ultimately you will find that it is the society that is the nourisher. It is the society that actually gives birth to them. And what happens? Even in a minute, you will find the dresses have been changed. The person who was deprived once, certainly when he gets power, he gets money, and he gets his position, you will find that the hunter is being hunted. Or rather, we should say that the person who was exploited, certainly he becomes the exploiter. So similarly, here also you will find that it took the whole of creation to produce my food, my each feather, and now I hold creation in my food. That is the irony. You will find the particular concept of neocolonialism that have been first uttered or maybe coined by the president of Ghana. And that actually indicates, you will find that whenever you will read Things Fall Apart, the novel by Chinua Achebe, there also the particular kind of an indication is there. And at the same time, in Achebe's other writings, you will find that even in a minute, the people got changed. Say, considering our own country, India, you will find that the colonists, they have first. And what happens? Do you find that the colonization is over? No. It is in work, always, you will find, in the name of different things, you see. There is provincialization, there is epidermalization, everywhere you will find that the process of exploitation is continuing. The society makes you leader, And when you get your power, your position, now it is the time to exploit others. That concept of neo-colonialism. And what the hawk is actually indicating? Its own power. What the hawk is actually speaking on? Its own position. And how he actually enjoys everything. So how this is happening? We will continue in our next lecture. Thank you.